All right, peace everyone. How you doing? Welcome to Beyond Breaking Barriers. I'm your host, Piper Carter, right here on Black Power Media. before we get started, just let me know that you guys could hear me in the chat. Peace to new member, E. Muhammad. Got a good show for you today. I do have to apologize because some of my references, I don't know, in trying to do download and upload, some of them are just, it just took too long for me to like have this episode ready for y'all today. But I appreciate everyone for tuning in and joining in. Peace to Yipper 99. As folks come in, I think I'm gonna have to just do my workaround, which is my written research. So instead of getting to hear these dopely produced pieces that I wanted to share with y'all gonna have to listen to me read. So it's all good though. I'll give my commentary in between. Sweary Fairy, Tracy Grenville, JM, Symbio Taxi. So as folks are coming in, just want to say peace to y'all. The episode today that I worked on is based on some thoughts that I have around the, so we've seen I guess in most recent years the sort of pop explosion, I don't know what you would call it, of folks, you know, is it going back to country music? I have thoughts about the why. And they're, you know, I'll admit, they're probably conspiratorial thoughts that I have about the why. Some of the why, I mean, obviously the why is always capitalism, making money, music business, you know, and the like. That's the most obvious why. I think also too, in the land of social engineering and, you know, the ways in which media is used to get market and get people to do things, I think it's also an opportunity to reach, I want to say politically, people who are needed, I would say, to be lulled or to feel good. I don't know. Peace, Jermon. I'm just sharing my conspiratorial thoughts at the off top, you know, about why I even wanted to do this show this evening. And I'm just saying, I do think there is, I always think there's political agenda, right? Especially with very loud, open, you know, visible artists, right? And so we saw this with the phenomenon of the Little Nas X, right? Where there is a resurgence and then lots of people were going back and doing a lot of history. And then just rethinking the conversation around genre. And also to, you know, more recently with, I'll say the more visibilization of younger Black people in the space, on, you know, various television shows, or I don't even know if it's called television anymore, but various media shows and things like that, that have become more popular. And then to, now we have Beyonce, right? And so part of me feels like this is them trying to reach that more conservative demographic, or that demographic that like doesn't want to be classified, if we're talking about Black folks, that doesn't want to be classified as typically Black, like your Candace Owens types. And also too, your more right-wing folks who think that they're like not racist, you know what I mean? Or yeah, because I don't know, I think everything's political. I look at all these things as like political tools that people use. And so I don't have proof. I don't have the receipt with the signature or anything. These are just thoughts I have just looking at the way that the visual symbolism that's used. Yeah. So anywho, Rudy Tooty. And then the ways that the stories are talked about, because as I've been doing the research, a lot of the ways in which the Black folks who are younger that are trying to reclaim country music, I think it is from a lot more liberal perspective. Because all the videos and things that I see are talking about we overcame and, you know, we overcame our triumphs. And, you know, it's the conversation is just positioned in a very commodified way. As like now we have access to like go back to our roots and like, you know, promote and brand and sell ourselves or something to that effect. And so, yeah, so I want to have a little bit different conversation. I do want to get into the commercialization aspect of it. It's on only a 90-minute show. So definitely, I'm not an ethnomusicologist. I'm not an official like musicology scholar. I'm like a fan of music, Black music, hip hop. I was one of those people who would purchase albums, look at the whole album, artwork, get into the artwork, look at who produced it, who wrote it, the whole thing, even who did the artwork, and just really into, you know, all the musicians, the instrumentation, and just trying to learn more. So that's how I'm approaching this conversation, is just as a music lover and a music fan who happens to see some things and possibly have opinions. So take that or leave it. And I will say that the way that I approached this research was that I think it was like a commercial on ABC, right? It came up, I went in the living room, my brother-in-law was watching something, and then it flashed like in the news. And the first thing I thought was, oh wow, Beyonce got ABC News promo. But within the promo, you know, what I thought was cool was she did talk about her inspirations and some of the she did uplift some of the historical figures. And so, like Linda Martell, right? And so in that, I said, you know, let me look at this, because if ABC News, or if the record label, I don't know, is she with Roc Nation? Anyway, but if the label and all that is putting it, like has promo slots on like ABC News, I'm more than convinced that there's a psyops that is for some social engineering, because it's everywhere. Like everywhere you look, it's there. So we all know that whenever you see an abundance of something all over the place, that's a signal, that's a message, that's something that they want you to pay attention to. And normally I'm the type of person that's like, oh, if everybody's doing it, I don't care. But I've kind of adopted this thing since doing the podcast. Like, let me pay attention and think about like, why this message? Why in this moment? And why in that way? Why is the conversation being promoted in that way to where it's like a we shall overcome type of conversation, right? It's a very we shall overcome. I don't know. Have y'all been paying attention? Black Power Media audience probably doesn't pay attention. I don't know. I'm making things up, but it's a very, like I said, very liberal, like, you know, now we've arrived type of thing. So I was like, yeah, that needs to be interrupted. So with that, I looked into these really interesting videos, and I found, and I'm late to the party because admittedly, I hadn't been listening to country music. I'll be honest. Okay, I'll out myself. I did listen to country music inadvertently because both my grandmothers, both my maternal and my paternal grandmother are from the South. My maternal grandmother, rest in peace, grandma, you know, Lily Hildreth Reeser, love you. That's Alabama in the deep South, closer to the Gulf, closer to Mobile, a little town like that. And I always talk about how my great, great, great grandfather, rest in peace, Sidney Burrell, and my great, great, great grandmother, Mama Julia Rose, rest in peace. That's my mom's, you know, my mom's dad's people, right? So they were all down in the same sort of area. It's called Marengo County. Now that's my mom's dad's family. My mom's family is also from Marengo County. So they're all from Marengo County. And like I said, it's my grandma would say it's in the country and rural Alabama. And in I think 1867, my great 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 grandfather Ambrose Hildreth, rest in peace, and my great 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 grandmother Emily Worthy, rest in peace. So he purchased 2,000 acres in 1867, and I don't know, as a part of his freedom. And so my family has owned that land that entire time. And so they owned the land, they farmed on there, that's how they lived. They built the church, they built the school, they built the cemetery, they built the whole town. So they've just been living insular. That town is all Black, right? And at this moment, it's huge. It's like all my relatives. It's called Hildrethville, right? It's inside of a town called Miller, which is inside of Marengo County, right? Like I said, it's closer to the Gulf. It's not far from Mobile, but a lot of my family, when they like left, you know what I'm saying? They went to Birmingham, right? Oh, peace, Jared. Yes, plants. I love plants. And so my family was very, you know, much about like that farm life, that you know, culture that's down there. And interestingly enough, they own all that. And like I said, they're Black and they still own it. We still own it. It's in my family, that whole thing. But culturally, they were very insular. As a matter of fact, my grandmother's youngest brother, who's still alive, shouts out to my Uncle Roosevelt, my great Uncle Roosevelt. I got a video of him. I did a couple videos of him when I went down, when my mom passed away in 21. I went down there, did a couple videos of him like on our land, just like talking about just talking about our history. And he told me stories about how, because they owned everything all this time, they actually had white folks sharecropping on the land. So they actually like, they had white sharecroppers that would come to them, and they were actually employing like white folks who were sharecropping. So I thought that was an interesting history. Another thing too, in order to get like to their land, they're surrounded by the KKK, who are also our relatives. I know. That's a whole nother stream for another day. But so they've been living like in there all that time. So I'm saying that to say that the country music was like their music. Like, you know, they made bathtub gin. I got stories and a couple of recipes, but I'll make some bathtub gin. They made music like what, you know, on the things that were there. So like washboard, like as a matter of fact, when I was a child, we still, when my grandmother generation family members would come over to my grandmother's house, we would all still be make that music. So I did grow up as a little girl, like actually being able to play in with some of that music. But it was the washboard. There, people would play the washboard. They would play the spoons. Obviously, hand bone, hand clap, and then like a, you know, the kind of call and response and this kind of thing. And so that was very like familiar to me, you know. And then my other grand, that's my mom's side. My mother, my father's mother is from Tennessee. And she's actually Black Indigenous. And I know Black people say that like all the time, but she's actually Black. She's actually Black Cherokee. And so they also in Covington, Tennessee, have one of the Black Cherokee Nation that's been independent like all this time. And she's from that nation and from that space. And so she grew up also in the same rural environment, listening to and playing this similar, very same kind of music. I also want to note that in the research, but I also already knew, so shouts out to my family for teaching me this as a child. I always knew that country music was Black music because when I was little and we watched Hee Haw and all that, I know, y'all, we did. We used to watch the Grand Ole Opry. We used to watch Hee Haw. I lived with my grandma, so that's what they, so, but when we would do all that, they actually would talk about different Black people who were doing this music, right? And they talked about how it was a Black music. Now, maybe they didn't talk about it in the ways that we talk about it in this time, but I'm saying that to say that they were actually naming the ways in which they were playing that music as a culture, right? And how it had been handed down to them, right? And so, okay, I gotta say this about that. So a couple of things first, and this is before I get into all the other part of it. So I think I've heard a lot of times when people say about, or I wanna say like a lot of younger people say things about, they never read it. They never, you know, they don't know where to read it. Much of, or I would even argue probably most of our history, especially the so-called Black American, but Black people in general, our, much of our history is not written down. Like much of our history is oral. It would have been handed down. So if you didn't get it from a relative, then you probably didn't get it because it probably was not written down. That's not to say everyone, but I want to say that a lot of our history just wasn't written. And so just like with any oral tradition, factual information can vary, right? Depending on, right? Like who's telling. There are some general things that might be similar or the same, or that might be the truth, but as we start to uncover much of what we are learning about our history, we have to kind of be detectives and piece together our lineages and our histories. And what I mean by that is, in one of the pieces of research that I was going through, one of the researchers was talking about how she found different like ads for to sell enslaved people, right? And some of the when in looking for some of the origins of the musicians and the music, that a lot of it had to kind of be decoded because it wasn't written in a way that honored or even recognized that people that this is what they, you know, what they did, right? But there would be things like in this sort of ad for enslaved folks is like plays fiddle, right? And this kind of thing. And so in a lot of the ways in which we're recovering our histories, we have to go back through the documents that we do have, which unfortunately are documents of the colonizers and this kind of thing, right? Because the ways in which we like wrote our history was a lot different, right? Than the ways in which these folks wrote our histories, and they were for different purposes, right? Like much of the ways in which they were writing about us was, number one, exterior about us, their observation of what they, their misunderstanding of what they thought they were seeing, and their interpretation or their misinterpretation, right? So a lot of meaning was lost and a lot of meaning was ascribed. And so we even going back to like study the history, it's important to kind of decolonize the research itself. So anyway, I'm saying all that because like I said, I wanted to play various videos for you, but for whatever reason, I don't have all of them. So I'm truncating a lot of information as I've been learning it. But then also too, I want to share, you know, some of my research sources. I think another thing that's important to note is we only have so much time, and there are so many places that we could go with this conversation. Since Jared is here, I really want to have this one conversation about the commodification of the art form. And so I'm going to queue up this one video because I don't know there's a documentary that Linda Martell, I don't know, maybe her, I don't know if her family produced it, but it's a little mini doc. And basically they asked her about, you know, her experiences. They're asking her, maybe it's the few years ago, but they're basically asking her, like, would you do all this again? Like, would you want to experience, you know, being a, like trying to do country music with all the things that you've experienced? Like, would you want to try to do this again? And she doesn't get to answer, which sucks. But but yeah, I think part of this conversation, which is a consistent conversation, is like about the commodification of art, right? We talk about it in hip hop a lot because we say there's a difference between hip hop culture and like the music business, which there is. And I think when it comes to all of our musics, right? Whether it's jazz, all the folk forms, that's a really interesting conversation, right? Because we know that in the 20s, that Billboard created this system of creating these genres, right? And the whole point of even creating the genres was to categorize musics in a way to market it, right? To understand demographics and to do marketing. And if we go back to the purposes of marketing, we know the whole conversation about marketing, and we take that back to the Nazis and that whole thing. But sticking just on the Billboard aspect of it, you know, looking at this music that came from that region that I'm telling you where my family's from, and it's not just those states, right? But it was, I got to say this one thing before I say that. Okay, boom, really quick. There's a different sonic soundscape when you travel around as well. Just put a pin there. But this music that was in this region, right? People played this music, right? So the very idea of like purchasing music, right? Like take your money, go someplace else, give someone some money to have a recording of these other people playing. Like, that's more of a more recent phenomenon, right? In history. We know that historically we played music, right? And music had different functions, whether it was for celebrations or ritual or just, you know, pure enjoyment for health. You know, there's all the different reasons that culturally, like, we played music, right? And we know that the music that we used in terms of a communication tool, you know, when we were working to resist, right? That music was a music that had coded meaning, right? We know that different words had coded meanings. We know that different sounds had coded meanings, right? And even the way in which we put it together, right? Tonalities, all that, had different sort of meanings. And so even as we're doing this research, like, there's no way to fully get the full picture from just actually, like, reading this stuff in books. Although reading it is great because you do get a lot of the history, but I think a part of this history as well is uncovering what was found, the recordings that were found or have been unearthed, and also looking for more recordings. And a lot of recordings have been done by or sit in a Library of Congress. There were a lot of interesting white folks doing different studies that were recording people from all over the place. I brought a couple of them for us today. And I think, you know, you have the commodification in terms of the research vein as well, too, because it's not just the music industry in terms of, like, shaping narratives and things. Research, the ways in which scholars can shape research to mean certain things, right? Like, we've seen this consistently, right, before. And so I love how in doing this research, I'm finding a lot of these people who have been doing this work for a while to really reshape and redefine, like, what that narrative actually is. Oh man, I'm looking for, here it is, boom. So I'm going to play this trailer, but not in this moment. I'm going to make sure that I play this trailer though. But something that I want to read to y'all is, I want to read an article. I feel like I'm all over the place, and it's mostly because I had clipped all these videos and I was trying to get them all up. And then in trying to get the videos up, it's just like, it's too much. I had too much to do. But I think one thing I want to do is, before we get fully into that commodification and where we are, there are a lot of sources that I've gone to today and yesterday in terms of looking up the history and the roots, the African roots of country music. And in that, there's a couple of conversations around genre, right? So we talked about how Billboard wanted to, you know, put things in the genre. I think even when we have conversations about our own history, maybe we could also rethink that conversation around genre. I'm gonna just put a pin in that as I start to talk about genre. But it's a thought that, like, came to mind that I was thinking. But because within, so country actually falls within a category of American folk music, right? And so within American folk music, you have various musics, of which blues is one, arguably jazz, maybe ragtime, right? You know, if these are arguable because those may be considered evolutions of folk. We have, you know, an unclear, I want to say this too. Just like borders are political, so are genres, right? So when we talk about, like, blues, or bluegrass or you know, country or hillbilly or any of these things. These are labels and things that were created so that blues and, you know, would be marketed more to Black folks, and, you know, hillbilly would be marketed more to white folks, although they could have hillbilly. but essentially we're talking about similar rhythms and instruments that are used and that are derived from the diaspora, right? And so when we're looking at these instruments that were used, well, one instrument we know is a banjo. And I have a lot of banjo videos and footage and research that I want to get to y'all. We'll see if I have enough time to like talk and keep y'all attention and transform these videos, because trying to get them up. Sorry about that. But we know that the history of the banjo was that it came from a gourd, right? And we know that there are several traditions in the central African basin, right? Which is like Cameroon and the Congo, where much of, and even Western Africa, right? Like in Mali, and there's just, and even Eastern Africa, right? Or in Ethiopia. So there are these various cultures that had similar practices around taking a sort of a gourd, right? Whatever it came from, whatever size it came from, and then letting it dry and then covering it with some sort of skin. And then there's like a hole in it, and then it gives you, right, like a certain sound. And the original gourd banjo had a much more warmer, lower tonality. It also didn't have, I forget what it's called, but the things at the top where you can kind of tune it. And so instead of being able, you know, in European traditions, a lot of their music is like layered with strings, right? So they take strings, and if you listen to all of their sort of musics, it's strings that are layered. Whereas in a lot more indigenous folks music, where you have this sort of gourd with the string, you gotta kind of like feel for in tune as you go. And so you're getting like one tone. And then if you want another tone, you kind of like go to that next tone. And so you'll hear the kind of tuning. You may hear it in it's not a gourd, but you might hear it in like a sitar, you know, or even in the oud, right? Or but definitely in the banjo. And you can hear where it's this kind of twangy kind of sound, right? That gives it, and as you know, play up and down, it gives you more of that sort of twanginess that you can kind of play with that, right? That's where the finger piano is also another instrument, right? I'm just naming like some of these instruments. We know that we also, peace to David Silberg as well. And so a couple of these references that I wanted to play, you know, another instrument was the voice. Right. And so another part of the pantheon, if you will, of aspect, or another piece of where we get the sound is also the voice. Right. And so we know, like, we had the call and response, but we've also had what they call like field hollers and this kind of thing. And so and also yodeling. Right. And that took me down the banjo rabbit hole, and it took me down the yodeling rabbit hole. So I found this video, but I chopped it up a bit just to make it a little shorter. But I wanted to play some of the yodeling. I did not edit this video. They use these flags. I know some of these flags are politically what they are, but it will give you an idea about kind of like where these sounds are coming from. So I'm going to play this video for you first. Okay, so again, those were just some of the examples of like some of the regions and cultures who actually, you know, use that vocal tonality to go, I think it's to the back of your throat and do like a, it's kind of a an opening and compression and where you use your voice to, you know, push that kind of a sound out. And we know that here, that also has been a part of our tradition. I think that the ways in which we have seen it in more modern times, we've actually been able to see some evolution of it. And I put even in I do want to honor that when I, definition-wise, when I speak of the Americas, I'm also including the Caribbean, right? Okay, so... So I put that in there because the way in which, so let me back it up just a touch. The narratives that we're given, right? A lot of times what we're missing is the ways in which we also, like, this was also our resistance music, right? This was also a way that we resisted. I think that when in the Bob Marley way that he resurrected that, I thought what was brilliant about it was it, and that's the way that we speak is through music, right? If you live in a hood, you know, a hood call when you hear a hood call. But in many cultures, there's either like a sort of whistle or some sort of call or sort of something where everybody who knows, right? And these are some of the ways in which we were able to utilize things that we had at our disposal, right? To defeat our enemy, number one, and also to escape, and also to protect ourselves, right? And to resist. And I think an important part of uncovering this lineage as we talk about it is not just in the context of finding records and who did or didn't get a Grammy, although that's all interesting. I think it's also useful, especially over here at Black Power Media, as a space where people are, you know, constantly working to figure out how to incorporate all these things into our work. And so what's interesting about that usage there is that song is called Chase Those Crazy Ballheads, which we know was a for all intents and purposes, you know, a song about folks who live in a community and they have a certain culture that they're practicing, and they are being tormented for practicing that culture, right? And so the song basically talks about, like, you know, we're not gonna just take this line down, right? We're gonna resist. And the song immediately starts out with this war cry, right? That's a war cry, right? It's like calling people, like, to get ready to, like, we're about to handle our business type war cry. And if you were, I can't even imagine, like, being from Kingston, Trenchtown, whatever, and hearing that, that probably would have made me go, like, ballistic. Because when I hear it now, that's one of the songs that, you know, that we play. But I'm just thinking about the music having that kind of usefulness, right? And that kind of power in our movements. I think I want to, let me see, where's another clip? So I wanted to share that. I think also too, when it comes to the voice aspect, we talked about, so that's kind of like where the kind of yodeling sort of sounds come from. But there's also like the field holler and this call and response. And then the ways in which sound can be used or has been used for what we would call healing, right? Or rituals or prayers, right? And over here, people have seen it in the spirituals and in gospel music and this kind of thing. And it also has roots. And I want to say, when we speak about our culture, there is no like one root, right? I think that that idea of there being like a one is a very colonizing idea, because we know that people migrate, people move around, people intermarry, people blend, and so do cultures and sounds, right? And so as we evolve, you know, these things evolve with us. They do have origins. So I do think it's interesting to trace things back to a sort of origin, but I think thinking of it in this way where it's like a pure, you know, one source type origin, I just think we need to reject that. So I'm saying that to say that I'm going to show you also an example of a video. I'm going to show you a video of a current, of a community that is currently practicing utilizing sound in such a way, but I want to honor that it does come from a very long tradition. Okay, so
Yambunesa, kwibarabara yibamba kunywe kuramba yambuneza yakwibaruka oyiwanyu murakomeye muturamukirize abiwanyu mwagize neza manye kwibaruka yambuneza ko mwababyeyi yambuneza sabye neza kunywe kwibaruka yambuneza ko shuti yanje yambuneza yakwibaruka abakuru mwaje neza tuzaniye amazi meza kwibarabara ngo yibomba muragahabwa n'Imana ihoraho yambuneza yakwibaruka yambuneza habwa n'Ima kwibaruka.
So I wanted to share that because I don't know if you could hear, there was a sort of transference of energy and back and forth, peace, Pancho, where they were actually feeding each other, right? And I think that that also too is a big part of our music and the way in which we do our music. We see it in hip hop. If you jump in a cipher and you catch it, you know, it's a thing. You see it in any, you know, in any aspect of our music. You'll see it in jazz with the improv. There's a certain aspect where everyone's kind of feeling a thing, and then people might use their instrument to respond. If you're singing, you might use your voice. You might use your voice to as an instrument to respond to another instrument, and vice versa. We've seen it in a more traditional sort of what they call field holler, where there is actual meaning in the call and response, because it was actually a message, and it was also a conversation, but it was also, what's the word I'm trying to say? Like a guidance, right? And so it had like a certain rhythm to it and a certain cadence. And those rhythms and cadences also help to tell the person like what to do. Now, in our cultures, we know that sound isn't separate from like, you know, the ways in which they would hang the quilts, right, in the window, and the certain pattern of the quilt would be the message to say, you know, which way to go, right? So I'm saying that to say that I think that what when in the research that I was doing for this, I think a lot of the field hollerers and a lot of the people who were doing a lot of the you know, explaining, right, kind of gave these really wonderful examples. And that's why I'm like, I'm trying to bring y'all some of these examples from here. You know, you can only put like 100 megabytes or something like that. Anyway, maybe it's 200. I don't know. But trying to put all these clips up here. So I think what I want to do is, while I do this, maybe I should read as well. So there is, oh man. And you know what sucks is like, I have all these videos, but I'm not able to like play them for you because I don't know. Like, I can't, like, I tried to do the share video thing, but I can't, I don't know. I can't share the, for some reason it doesn't hear it. But what I do want to do is, while I work on uploading this video, I want to read a little bit so that y'all have some of these references where I'm getting stuff from, because I think that that's important, is to share these references. And so which one is it? Let me see. Oh, that's pretty interesting. It only shows it if it's in Chrome. Okay, so let me open this up in Chrome. Close that. Yeah, I had opened it up in Safari. It's not giving me the Safari window. Let's go here. And let me see if y'all can see what I see. Go back over to present. And okay, there we go. Boom. So this is, let me see. What do y'all see? Can you see what I see? Oh, there it's coming. Okay, boom. I don't know why it's taking its time like that. But as it comes in, I'm readying a video for y'all. I got so many videos that let me see that I okay, there we go. All right, boom. So let's close that. Again, I am not an ethnomusicologist, nor am I a scholar. I'm just a fan. But so I'm gonna read this, and I do want to say that there are several, the way in which borders have been chopped up, it makes it seem as though like this nation, you know, or tribe is just here. But there are migrations of nations that are similar or that have that share things, you know, culturally. And so I don't mean to give the impression of like these borders are definitive and things are cut and dry. Like, we understand how these borders are political and all of that. So I want to say, so this research, let me just give you this real quick. So Suzanne Fernice, for the French National Center for Scientific Research, wrote this on Dieli and Yeli, and it's yodeling in two musical cultures of Central Africa. Okay, so this is the abstract. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to just read it. But I do think a couple of points are important. So I'll just read it. I don't agree with all the language use and the way that it's used. I'm reading, so forgive me. So she says, on the African continent, the yodeling technique is known as one of the characteristics of pygmy and bushman music. And we know that some folks that pygmy has been a pejorative, and at the same time, some folks have reclaimed pygmy culturally. But just wanted to put it out there. So this article is a cross-cultural comparative approach to yodel within two musical heritages of Central Africa. And so, namely, those of the Aka or Ba'aka of the Central African Republic and the Baka of Cameroon. That is two distinct pygmy groups. The first part is dedicated to Aka music and gathers research scattered in articles published mostly in French. It treats with the relation between singing techniques and social context and basic rules of Aka counterpoint, and with the phonetical study of the yodel technique. The second and main part contains mainly unpublished materials concerning Baka yodeling. It focuses on the symbolic value of yodeling, on polyphony and the incidence of yodeling on the formation of melodic variations. And furthermore, it reveals some strategies of suggesting the yodel without realizing the typical mechanisms of change. And so these are just some resources and stuff that she has here. I'm not going to go like fully into the research because the whole show isn't just about yodeling, but I just wanted to bring that into the conversation to honor, you know, where some of these sonic, you know, traditions are actually coming from. So with that, let me see. I'm trying to get a video from my phone onto here. So with that, I did a lot of research around banjo. I really wish, I don't understand why when I click present that we can't hear a YouTube video. And I don't know, because I see people do it all the time and I changed my settings. They said to put the sound, but I don't even have, it doesn't even give me that as an option. So that sucks. But, and I just uploaded a video, so I don't know why I can't find a video that's on here. Or maybe, oh, I see, there it is here. Okay, boom. All right. Sorry, guys. I'm looking for this one video that was an interview. Like I said, let me see. I'll just put all these on there. And then, well, I just, where did this video go? I apologize, y'all. I had this stuff all set up and I went to go put it on my expand drive to like bring here, and then all of a sudden I start having all the technical difficulties. But let me see if it'll do it again. But anyhooty rooty tooty. So we went over yodeling. Okay, and I talked about the history of the banjo. Like I said, some great, what's the sister's name that did the phenomenal banjo? Let me just at least shout her out so y'all can look her up if you need to look her up. So in doing this research, oh, let me say this about that, because sources are really important. There's a young woman. Her name is Rihanna Giddens. Okay. I really love the work that she's been doing. She's been doing this for not 20 years, but a little less. Thank you. Yeah, Rihanna Giddens. She's been doing this for a little less than 20 years. Y'all probably know her, Black Power Media. She has a dope video that I had all chopped up and wanted to intersplice. Well, she has several videos where she breaks down banjo history. And I have a lot of banjo history here written. But I'm like, wow, it's so much history. Like, as I started going down the rabbit hole, I really started looking at, you know, this banjo and then, you know, the field hollerers, and then just the ways in which the lineages of sound and instruments, in terms of the specific instruments that were used and even the adaptations once they came here, right? I really started looking at like where, when we hear, like where these traditions are coming from and the ways in which we hear them now. Like now, the majority of music is like love songs, right? I'd say a large portion of music, whatever genre, is usually about tainted love, lost love, longing love, some sort of love. Not all, but definitely, you know, much of it. And so I think, you know, when we start looking at how we could use this in our movements, I know that as I've traveled, I've heard some different folks like still practicing some of these traditions. You know what I mean? Like some of these traditions. And I say I've heard them practicing some of the traditions, and they use them in the land of, like, they do what's called like místicas. And when you do a mística, you do storytelling, you might do some acting out, you might do some singing, you might play some music together. And the stories that you're telling are about movement, resistance, history, this kind of thing. So I think that that's one way, right, that we can, that we can, you know, reclaim. I feel like that the Mysticas that I have participated in have I've never participated in Mystica that was here. I mean, like in like so-called United States. Yeah, I've never like been in a Mystica here. Man, this video is too large. You know what I'm gonna have to do? I gotta figure out how to chop this video up. But it's not gonna happen like during this show. This sucks. Man, I did all this work for nothing. I can't even show you all the references I pulled. But I have my written references because I had all these like video references because I was like, they don't want to hear me read. But I do want to say, okay, I do also want to say that in the research that I'd done, I mixed it with like reading a lot of these articles and journal entries with excerpts from various books that have been written, and then mixed that with watching some of the videos of the people who've been keeping the traditions alive. And this conversation about the commodification of music, it is a central theme, I want to say, like throughout the things that I've read and the things that I've watched. And I think I want to connect that to a conversation that Jared, I think, is usually having about the music industry and the myth of Black buying power. And in the one documentary that was about Linda Martell, right? It named her as the first woman on Hee Haw, the first woman of the Grand Ole Opry. Lot of first type of achievements. And I know that over here we think that saying the first is disgusting. And it is. And at the same time, I think that that is sometimes unfair to not value what a person's journey was, and things that they've, I think it diminishes what people have endured. That's just a personal thing. But anyway, so she was like a contemporary of Charlie Pride, right? And so Charlie Pride, Black country music, like superstar icon. And like his documentary and everything was interesting too. Like, anyway, that's the whole thing. But back to her. So in her documentary and trailer and all that that I watched, basically she had been approached by the record label owner. Somebody look it up. I'm not located in this moment. I have to go through too many notes. And he, to get his name, I'm saying, not that it matters, we don't care about him, but if you want to know his name. So he owned this record. He owned like a record label, and he had different subsidiaries, right? Like on the label. And one of the subsidiaries, he approached her, and it was called Plantation Records. And that's his gimmick, right? So he had Plantation Records and she was his artist. And so they did the song, the music, the record, the album. And I guess to his surprise, it did really well, right? I don't know if it was a joke. I don't know, but it did really well. And like I said, she started getting a lot of success, but then came the pushback, right? And with that, then she ended up, like, she did another record, but they ended up shelving it And then she just decided to like leave the business. She started driving the school bus. She would perform around in her community. She started to be kind of known. But in essence, she just was like, gave up. Charlie Pride ended up becoming, I don't know, a millionaire and owning a lot of businesses that are terrible for humanity, and, you know, just becoming rich and then being this Black icon in, as a the Black, you know, country music like phenomenon, right? And but even with all that, there are some interesting things that he said, you know. They did one interesting interview. They had interviewed him. They'd gone down to where he's from in Mississippi. And it was like, he, I guess he's one of 11. And then they interviewed him with his father. And, you know, his father told you like typical Black stories, like he used to get spanked and all this kind of thing. I know for millennials and Gen Zs, y'all are like spank, but for Gen Xers, it was spank. But, and so, you know, he asked him about, you know, when you, like from where you came from, because he talked about how he had picked cotton and he grew up picking cotton. And a lot of his music was talking about when he was picking cotton and where he came from and trials. But he had a lot of love songs too. But, you know, they asked him about that, and he had that same kind of story, like the same liberal story. But something that he said, I thought was super interesting, because the interviewer had asked him, like, you know, what do you think about when you're, you know, like being from Mississippi and, you know, you're traveling all around, and, you know, you're not, you know, you came from this life of like picking cotton, and now you're like this country music icon. And I don't have the answer like verbatim, but the way in which he answered it was basically like, even though he was this person that was like supposed to be doing all that, you know, like being successful and all that, He still had to like do it in a way that was devoid of like truly valuing, right? Like all of who he was. Peace, Rouse, pasta sauce. And so the one manager told the story about how there was some gig, and it was, I don't know if it was Chicago or something, and I think the plane broke down, or no, it was a storm or something like that. But they, whatever it was, they couldn't take the plane. And he was like, and if it was any other, you know, superstar, they'd have been like, oh, you got to cancel the gig. But he jumped in his car and he rode like 300 miles to the gig. And the way the manager was saying it, oh, he also was saying like, Charlie used to wear this chain that said GID, which stood for like get it done. And that was like a story that he was telling, because he was saying he would figure out, he'd get it done. And something I realized that was kind of missing from that narrative, even, I don't know, maybe Charlie knew it, but wasn't thinking to say it. But the way in which the manager described it was like how hardworking Charlie was, and how that was like a virtue and a value. But something that I feel like I heard was like, he's gonna miss his gig, right? Like, he would have missed the gig. Like, that means he probably needed that money, right? If he wasn't, if he didn't go to the gig, he didn't have the luxury like those other white artists to be like, cancel the gig, right? Like, he probably needed that gig. And he probably drove that 300 miles because he was like, I can't afford to like have a gig canceled. So, I mean, so that's a whole thing, and that might be a first world problem. But I take it back to when we talk about this commodification of music in general and the commodification of artists and the commodification of Black artists, right? And that lineage between people being literally being used as cash or being used as a commodity, right? To work, right? And create wealth for this system, for others, right? And for this whole colonial project. And all the ways in which, while being a part of this colonial project, and that's here in the so-called United States and also in the Americas, right? All the Americas, so including the Caribbean, right? When we think about the ways in which we resisted that colonial project, the imperialist colonial project, right? And there were several ways that we resisted. And the importance of music and the role of music in our resistance. Like I said, the role of music as messages, as a way to connect, as a way to heal, as a way to survive. We're usually taught the more like the stories of triumph, like how I got over that type of, you know, narrative, which I don't fully reject because you gotta have some way to have mental health, right? But I'm just saying we only get like a little portion of the story. Some stuff, as I've been doing my research, I've been looking for the where that we've used this as a tool to fight back and resist and win. And in terms of how that relates to the commodification, I think that, you know, there's power in the music. Like there's power in that music. Like it's undeniable. There's power in that music. It basically created culture for the whole entire world. And when folks encounter it now, or even then, especially in the context in which it would have been encountered, right? Because it would have been encountered in some sort of ceremonial practice, in some sort of circle with a lot of people doing it all at one time, and it would have had a different sort of feeling to it, right? Understanding like that power, that is what I think the colonizers wanted to commodify, right? That we're trying to get that energy or whatever that was. And it was the commodification of that part, right? And so, yeah, no, like in terms of the whole project of colonization and the whole project of imperialism, I mean, yeah, we weren't in on any of it, right? So, and I know that the conversation that has been a consistent conversation, especially with liberals, is people want in on it. What's up, James? Is that people want in on it, right? I mean, that's when liberals talk about, you know, reclaiming our legacy, or like, you know, telling our stories or rewriting our stories, it's from a context of like, so that we could commodify it. And I just want to be clear that what I'm talking about is not about like the ways in which we didn't get to participating in commodifying our own culture. Like, I don't want to talk about like, oh, they left us out the music industry, because like the whole industry is just another industry, right? Which is a part of the system. And so, of course, it's going to mirror the original industries, right? Which was the commodification of people, the commodification of labor, right? The devaluing of people, the greed and, you know, the disregard for, you know, humanity, much less basic human rights. And so, yeah, like I think when we have these conversations about uncovering our histories and uncovering our culture, and maybe I'm sensitive because I know over here in Black Power Media, like, y'all don't like cultural nationalists. Although I don't identify personally as a cultural nationalist, I'd probably, if I was forced to identify something, I'd probably say I'm more of like a cultural Pan-African internationalist. And growing up as a cultural nationalist, I think the ways in which culture was used, as I saw it in movement, was useful and powerful. Like I said, my uncle, who was a poet and a musician, was also one of the founders of League of Revolutionary Black Workers and also one of the founders of Republic of New Africa. And so that's what I grew up in, where music, poetry, film, arts, culture was a part of our movement. It was a part of our resistance, is a part of what we did. And that was just in the 70s, right? In the 80s. So I do find use for it. You know what I mean? And we all listen to music. None of us is sitting here telling us and we don't listen to no music. We don't watch no films. We don't enjoy, you know, these things. And we do need more connection, right, to music and art and things that actually give us power and empower us. I think in understanding this lineage and dismantling these narratives of, well, now we can win a Grammy, or why doesn't Beyonce have the top artist, or, you know, that kind of conversation. I think, yeah, like, what are the ways in which we could rediscover our historical roots of our culture, whether that's music, you know, we're talking about country music right now, so we can keep it there. And how do we utilize what we know now and to empower ourselves, right? And even when we talk about like the ways in which we did not have control or don't have control over the industry or industries, you know, manufacturing, production, right? And even the ways in which we identify as consumers. I'm not saying that me, you, Black Power Media people identify as consumers, but I think that we're made to identify as a consumer, which is the reason we're still practicing all these genres, the reason we're still boxing people in, like, with genre, right? And so even the idea of, like, oh, the industry won't, you know, promote Black artists. Like, we have, even within our own ecosphere, ways to like actually gain control of the means of our distribution, production, or even have our own, dare I say, industries. I don't know if that's the proper word that I want, because I'm like, do we want to mirror this system that we're dismantling? Or what is it that we want to create? Or what are the ways in which we can make sure that people who do want to live their lives and sing and dance and make music, that they can be taken care of fully, right? And have their bills paid and be able to, you know, be creative and do creative things. And what are the ways in which like that, those creations also like benefit society, right? Like, how does the music that people are making actually like add to culture, uplift culture, and contribute to culture? You know, I mean, I have more questions than answers, just because in doing all the research and uplifting, like the banjo, for instance, like that was is a very powerful instrument, right? It was used mainly in ritual, right? You see, it's made from a gourd. I mean, I play capoeira, and a beaning bow kind of looks like a banjo. It's like a banjo. Ding, 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 ding. And you play it just like you play a banjo. Whereas a banjo, you play, right? Like, you know, but it's still, you could tell that it still comes from like that same lineage. And I can tell you in Capoeira, peace, Sugar Shan. And what I can tell you, like in Capoeira, when the maestra or whoever's playing the beating bow, they kind of direct, right, the energy. Like you get in what's called a hora, which is a circle. And then you kind of get on each other's rhythm. You know, you have like the clap, you know. Right. And so everyone's clapping. And then, you know, you might, it might be fast. It might be slow. And you might be stand-up game. You might be, you know, Angola game, whatever. But the thing is that the beanie bow and the people playing the instruments, like the tambourine and all that, they're actually, the maestro is controlling like the energy, right? So they might play a certain rhythm or something, and then they'll, that gives an understanding to the people that are in the circle to know like what type of game, right? And then, you know, you go in, you ask for the permission, then you enter into the circle, and then you, you know, fight with your partner, dance, play with your partner. So I think of like, just in playing capoeira, like, and that beanie bow, and the way that that is like almost an upright banjo, and it has a very similar tonality, you play it very similarly that you do a banjo. And I think of the banjo as controlling energy as well. And in a lot of my research that I've read, it talked about the banjo as a resistance tool and how, you know, when you blend it with a lot of these field hollers, people were able to like escape. And I listened to one person tell a story on one of the archives. I'm going to find his name. And basically he had told a story how he had escaped the jail. And, you know, they had those jails that was like outside, plantation type jail where they make you work on the plantation. But as, you know, as a jail, this is like in the '40s. And he was saying that the interview is taking place, I think maybe in the '70s or '80s. So he had been out for a while, but he was telling how he escaped jail. And he was saying that they had taken them out to work this field. And when it was decided that he would get away, they started doing this like the field holler, like call and response thing. And the way in which he starts doing the song, like I see the, you know, like I see the fence, I'm gonna go over there. He's like, go, brother, go, you know. So it's like this whole sort of thing. He said, and that old mule ain't gonna stop me now. Like, go, brother, go. And so it's like they were like actually calling in response to each other, but they do it way more like amazing, and they use the like yodel throat, and this whole thing is amazing. And he basically talked how they like helped him escape because they were just singing this whole, they were singing back and forth the whole way as he was like escaping, right? So, you know, and there are so many stories of that, right? That's like a pretty normal story that I've heard about like using music and that call and response thing as a way to escape. There were other, you know, sounds and songs and things that they use to like give different messages about when it was time to go, like what was going on with the constellations at the time, or what was going on with the terrain, or, you know, if it was safe or unsafe, or, you know, the path that you should take. So there was all of that kind of thing. But then there were also just some songs to like hype people up, because there were just straight up songs that talked about how they were murdering slave owners and things. And songs of resistance and songs of, you know, battle. I'm using the word battle, but yeah. So I think, yeah. And the co-optation of like country music, right? That's a whole, that's a music industry thing, right? Because like I told you in the beginning, both my grandmothers always listened to country music. And it wasn't, it wasn't just like records played, like we actually like played it, right? And I think that that's a tradition of that like practice and oral tradition, like that whole thing. I don't know, do families even do stuff like that anymore? I know my family did it a lot. And even now we get together, we do play music for each other, but we did actually used to play together. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Well, let's just say they did songs about how to get rid of the exterminate the slave owner. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Yipper. We did, you know, well, they allegedly did those things, you know, to escape. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't like anybody was, you know, letting them retire with a 401k. You know what I'm saying? Like, and I think with the banjo tradition, in using the banjo, there's certain tonalities, like I said, that come with. So you have like a gourd banjo, which is like the original banjo, and even with the instruments. Like when we're talking about commodification, you go from people that were actually like craftsmen, or they may have been like a spiritual leader, or they're a certain person. Because when you make, I don't know if any of y'all do African drum and dance, but in different traditions, even in more modern traditions, like salsa, people play like bata, you have to be like initiated into being able to make certain instruments, and you have to be initiated to even like play certain ones. And that's more from an African spirituality perspective. And like I said, it's certain instruments, but those instruments came through the Maafa, and folks brought those, you know, traditions here. And so we're making very like similar instruments and still had the same understandings of the usefulness and the ways in which they could be used. And so when they would carve out or dry out the gourds in different sizes, they have like different tonalities. Well, as you're making the instrument, you're putting, you know, intentions into it, right? So it's going to have certain intentions. And so the banjo was also seen as like a kind of, you know, scary tool. I think as the banjo was, should I say was taken from Black people? Well, I'll say through the menstrual period, right? So I've seen a lot of videos of people saying that the banjo was equated with like white culture. In my experience, I won't say I didn't know why people did a banjo, but I always thought the banjo was a Black instrument because that was always taught to me. Maybe because I grew up in African-centered culture, African-centered school, my people played it. Maybe that was what I knew of it. So I always equated banjo with Black. But in my research, I'm learning that a lot of people think that banjo is equated with white, but it's actually a diasporic creation. And it, like I said, it comes from some of the other gourd instruments that had some different shapes and different materials and things, but it's a very similar understanding of how it's made and how it's played. And so when it comes here and it's equated with Black folks and in the so-called slave quarters and this kind of thing, when the menstrual period comes in, then you have white folks imitating or making fun of Black folks. And so they start playing banjo, and then you have Black folks making fun of white folks, making fun of Black folks playing banjo, right? And so it gets connected to this minstrel idea, right? And so then it becomes a white, like a white instrument, you know? Although, like, we talk all the time about the connection to Ireland. If y'all have ever seen, you know, some of the, what is it, the Irish jig, which they get from different African cultures, right? Because when we got here, it wasn't like we just came from one place, right? And so they're getting it from different African cultures, like these steps, these quick steps, which they call the Irish jig. And also too, there's stories of when the Africans were on the ships coming over, the human trafficking ships, when they were coming over, they would bring them up top for like exercise, and they would make them dance. And so they would make them like dance and play like these string instruments. And so a lot of times they were getting that the you know, enslavers on the ship, the traffickers on the ship were making them like perform, right? And so, you know, they were doing a lot of their dance steps and blending with that. And so there have been accounts that have been written about that happening. And so as you begin to, like I said, trace back where the European would have seen this, could have been on top of a ship, right? Or it could have been if they were like living on plantation, or it could have been, right? Also too, when they would have the auctions and things, if people had a certain like talent or whatever, right? I mean, or skill, right? They would make them like do the thing so they could, you know, sell them or whatever. So that's another place where the European would have seen it. But the European writes about it, and I think when we first see European write about it, it's around the 1700s, right? And we all know that our culture like severely predates like Europeans finding out about banjo and yodeling in the 1700s, right? So, and then I guess the adaptation is when during the minstrel shows, I'm kind of jumping around a bit, sorry about that. But then during the minstrel shows with the European copying, or the white person, because they weren't European once they became white, but the white person, you know, copying the banjo, I guess that's where it became like a white sound and a white instrument. And then when we go to Billboard, right, in the 20s, well, even before then, right, when they create these genres to promote and market music to people, they decide to do it in a way so that they can promote this hillbilly stuff to white folks, and then and country, and then they're going to promote like blues, right, to black folks. We could argue, which we do, the similarities between country and blues and the origins of rock. We know that blues is the origins of rock. There's country that sounds like blues. The lines are pretty blurred. We know that bluegrass has its origins, right, in the same region and the same spaces as blues, right? And there's an argument as to, you know, is bluegrass white folks blues, right? And then we have the early string bands that did consist of banjo that we do have from like the 1800s, right? Which is black people. And so like I said, I have all these video references, but I was trying to upload them into the StreamYard, but they're like too big. So I would have to do a whole nother day of chop, chop, chop and get all these clips down to like 30 or 60 seconds. But, and also do a lot of compression. I don't know. I was doing that stuff the last couple of days. They didn't upload. So I wanted to show y'all this brother playing a banjo that revived the banjo. I wanted to show you this elder that was doing some field hollering that told the story I told you when he escaped prison. There's another one I wanted to show y'all where the young lady, Rihanna Gidden, she's got a lot of really good videos, but she does a really good one. Well, not just one, but there's one in particular she does on the banjo. So look that one up. But she has a lot of great talks. What I like about her is that she is at least out of her mouth saying that she wants to decolonize this. And she has a deep an anti-capitalist framework for the way that she is approaching unearthing this history. She is Black. She identifies as Black. She says she's mixed race, but that she identifies as Black. There's another young lady. Her name is, what's her name? She probably got unearthed from Beyonce. Reese Palmer, who has this Color Me Country show that she was doing, where she's doing different, she gives grants with her organization to young country artists of color to be able to produce material, perform. She creates a show for them. And then she also, if I'm not mistaken, what else does she do? Oh, she's the one who was in that documentary that I was telling you about Linda Martell. Linda Martell has a documentary. So look up her documentary. There is another young man. I'm telling you all this because I had all these queued up and for some reason I can't play you clips from YouTube on here. I'm going to have to talk to Dr. Ball, see how are y'all doing? How are y'all able to do that? Cuz I'm like I can't get the sound to work for some reason. Was it trying to see what was the other young man's name? So the one guy's name is Joe Savage, the one I was telling you that escaped from jail. That story is dope. Look that up, or you could just look up Field Holler. There is, let me see. I'm trying to see what this other young man is. This him? There's this other young man. No, that's not him. There's this other young man that's from Providence, Rhode Island. Oh, what's his name? And it's on Vox, VOX, not FOX. It's on Vox, and his name is Jake Blount. He also identifies as Black and mixed race, and he has a great video about Black American folk music and the banjo. And I'm just giving y'all these references because these are all the references that I had pulled up, but I'm not able to play for y'all. And I really feel bad about that because I had this whole great show that was playing for y'all, but it is what it is. And then again, right, the Linda Martell, like check her out and check out her documentary. And but anyway, so before I go, I want to say thank you to everyone who came by and stopped by. I'll figure out next time when we do clips and things how to get all these clips up in here. I'll probably have to do another like 3 days of clipping instead of two. But I appreciate y'all for stopping by. I want to thank y'all for, you know, sticking around, watching. I hope that I'm bringing you value and something that's useful to you. I hope that you go and check those resources out. I think we need to change the conversation from just that, you know, either the commodification of our arts and our music to like, how are we using these cultural tools that we have and using them within our movements, because they're very powerful tools that we have. And uncovering this history, you know, also helps us to humanize the people that we learn about, the people that we read about, because we know that our culture isn't just these stories, right? We know our culture is full of like sounds and smells, and that when we get to hear these sounds, they kind of bring to life like those moments, right? Like when you get to hear these voices, it actually helps to humanize, or, you know, these folks that were just a person, right? Just before, we get to actually just learn more and feel more, right? Learn more through that feeling of listening and resonating, right? We get to hear the tonalities, we get to hear the inflections, we get to hear, you know, we get to hear. So yeah, I think I'll put a period there. But like, share, subscribe here on Black Power Media. We'll see you next Monday right here, 8 p.m. And then I guess y'all are going to be in the morning for the morning show. You know, check out the morning show and all the rest of the shows that are here on Black Power Media. And appreciate everyone for stopping by. And I'll see y'all. Y'all have a wonderful week. And I will see y'all next week. Peace.